rock and roll station and a rock and roll dream. She's making movies on location. She don't know what it means. Welcome everybody back to another episode of the Matt Levine My Generation podcast. Julian, I picked out that song especially for you. Well, Dire Straits, Skate Away Tonight. But I picked out that line because you're a filmmaker, and so I wanted to come up with a lyric that involved making movies on location, as Dire Straits like to say. So welcome, my friend. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thank you guys so much for having me. I'm doing really good tonight.
No, thank you for coming on. I appreciate that. Noah, how you doing?
I'm good. Ready to rock and roll.
You guys do anything exciting today?
Not really. Just kind of bundled up under a blanket on my couch today for the most part. It got really cold today, so
yeah,
that's pretty much been my whole day after school.
I actually fixed my first light bulb today.
Really? How'd it go?
One of the light bulbs went out in my room. So actually the other night it went out, and my mom wanted me to fix the light bulb.
Yeah.
And so originally I was like really scared because, like, when you're going to fix a light bulb, you don't want the, have you fixed a light bulb before, Julian?
I have not. I am like, you are too scared.
Okay. So the lights are on. So I'm like, all right, we can't do this with the lights on. And she's like, just don't look up at the light when you twist it in. I'm like, how's that possible? Because this is my first time doing it. So we turn on my, I turn on my lamp over here, I turn off the lights. And this is like an LED light bulb or something.
Yeah.
And so like I'm twisting it in and it keeps getting stuck for some reason. So it's just not working. Oh. So we tried to do that yesterday and it was a total failure.
Yeah.
But then came back today. I was alone in my room this time. And I have to say, it was pretty easy. It was pretty
easy. Well, congratulations on your new light bulb.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Noah, have you changed the light bulb before?
I've not.
So that's one thing that I'm ahead of you guys in life for. Anyway, Julian, you're a filmmaker. Yeah. I don't want to put the high school tag on you because I hate being called a high school podcaster. You're just a freaking cool filmmaker. That's what I'm going to say.
Thank you so much. It's really annoying. Yeah, I totally get that. Thank you.
It's like the high school tag. I hate the high school tag after everything. Because it's like, oh yeah, sure. It's cool that a high schooler is podcasting. It's cool that high schooler is filmmaking. But we're adults. Just get rid of the high school tag.
Yeah. Thank you. I totally get that. Yeah.
So I want to talk about a few of your films later, especially To Become a Witch, which congratulations. That was accepted into the Krampus Film Festival last week.
Thank you so much. I'm super excited for that one. Yeah.
So I just want to start there real fast. What was that like? Like to kind of get that email, or how did it come, over phone, email?
That one came over email. I did, excuse me, I was a little nervous. It took a couple weeks after the notification date for them to get to me. Mm-hmm. So I was a little nervous about what was going to happen there. But then they alerted me over email and I was really excited. It's hosted by the Asbury Park Paranormal Bookshop,
which is
the place I really, really love. I've been there once or twice. I went on a tour there. It's really fun. I'm a firm believer in the supernatural. I just love it there. Love everything creepy. So it's really cool to have a film presented and distributed by a place that I really personally love.
And so for our listeners, we're gonna put Julian's YouTube channel in the description, as well as To Become a Witch and a few other movies that we're gonna talk about later. But first, I want to start. How do you kind of get introduced into filmmaking? Because it seems like you've been doing this for a while. I've been following your page for a little while now.
Oh, thank you. First off, it's weird, you know. I listen to a lot of interviews with other filmmakers, mm-hmm. and I read a lot of biographies, and for them, there's always kind of like one key moment in which they realize, oh, this is what I want to do. I want to make films.
Yeah.
For me, it was kind of a bunch of different elements. I remember in third grade for Hanukkah, what I wanted like more than anything was a video camera. And it wasn't like, I didn't know that it was something I could make a career off of or something I could make art with. It was just like a fun toy more than anything else, to make like dumb videos with my stuffed animals, which I made a lot of. And so I got the camera, I started playing around with it. And that same year, my parents got me for Christmas, I think, a collection of 100 classic horror movies. Now, they were not classic by any means. They were just old public domain movies that this company could get the rights to.
Yeah.
But I was obsessed with them. I was glued to the screen. And from there, I started getting into more types of horror and like actual really scary stuff. And I distinctly remember, I guess if I had to choose a single moment, mm-hmm. it would be when I watched this classic 50s film, Strangers on the Train. It's directed by Alfred Hitchcock, possibly my favorite director. Really, he's made just mm-hmm. some amazing films. And I started to notice the camera angles. It was the first film I ever saw where—
How old were you at the time?
Man, I think I was either 9 or 10, you know, either late third grade or early fourth grade.
That's incredible. Like you were you were watching 1950 film, and not only that, you were focusing on like the intricacies of it, the camera angles.
Yeah. So that was really the first moment where I realized, whoa, what did the director just do there? Like where I wasn't just sitting down and watching a film for entertainment. I realized, wait, what's going on here? This is really cool. Mm-hmm. So the next day I remember going out like 10 a.m., really sunny day. And I started mimicking the camera angles, not even telling a story, just like playing around. And then I was like, oh my God, like I can actually do this. And from there, I just took off. I started taking classes. NJ Film School, I want to give a quick shout out to them in not Paramus, New Jersey, New Brunswick or something. NJ Film School, they are like, if there's anyone listening who wants to learn more about film and is younger, it's a great place. I learned everything about film I know there. Mm-hmm. And from that point on, I just like started making stuff.
That's awesome. So like, what was your parents' reaction like initially when you're like to them, hey, this is something I want to pursue?
They of course, they've been really supportive all the way through. They bought me, you know, tons of camera equipment. I have tons of stuff now, lots of lights. They've bought me all these glasses. They've just been really supportive. There wasn't a lot of shock. I think ever since I was little, I've been, you know, less inclined to be interested in like STEM stuff mm-hmm. and more to the creative side, even before I did film stuff.
Hey,
but yeah, they've really just been supportive the whole way through. Yeah.
Awesome. So you began to make films and you attended a lot of NJ Film School classes.
Yeah.
I guess, what was the moment? Is there a project that stands out for you where you were kind of like, hey, I'm pretty good at this. Like, this might be the real deal here.
I'd have to rewatch some of my stuff. For a while, I mentioned this briefly before, when I first started like getting into filmmaking and like making stuff, I made stuff with my stuffed animals and toys. Mm-hmm. Like I would just film my stuffed animal moving around and I would just talk into the camera like what they were saying.
One day you're gonna have to release those as like an archives box.
Actually, I gotta find them. They are on a computer in my basement that's broken, but if I get that computer fixed, I really want to see them again. They'll be embarrassing like crazy, but I really want to see them. But the first film I made, where this is one that's never been released, I don't even think I have the videos anymore, where I realized like, oh, I'm actually kind of good at this. It was just on that same third grade video camera, I just made a horror movie, not edited together at all. Just like random shots. And like, if you played the shots through kind of like a slideshow, it would tell mm-hmm. a story. And I'm like, whoa, I just made a story without my stuffed animals.
Yeah.
And it's not terrible. And so I think that was like sixth or seventh grade or so. And from there on in, I started like getting my friends involved too and making more and more stuff.
So why scary movie? Like why horror?
Oh, I wish I could tell you now. It's like, it's such a weird genre, because when someone goes and see a horror movie, they are saying to themselves, well, I am going to go pay money to get the crap scared out of me. I'm going to go pay money to not sleep tonight. I don't know. I've always been kind of intrigued by creepy things. You know, when I was little, do you know the Goosebumps books by R.L. Stein?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I never liked to read those because I was scared. Like,
yeah, you know, they were scary stuff for kids. You know, as a kid, I really love them. I guess, Overall, I think the reason I've kind of stayed by horror through all these years, like I said, I've always been kind of interested in them. And when my parents bought me that set of 100 horror movies, that's what kind of really set me off. But the reason I've stayed with it for all these years is it's kind of like the underdog of movie genres. You know, you can watch any given...
The Rocky of movie genres.
Yeah, exactly. It's the Rocky of movie genres. That's a great analogy. You know, you watch the Oscars every year and the winners are all usually like romance, really depressing drama films, historical pieces, pretty much every genre you can think of, even occasional indie comedy, some fantasy and sci-fi like Star Wars was nominated. Mad Max Fury Road a couple years ago, great movie, by the way.
You know, I enjoyed that one too.
Fantastic film. But you know, really horror is the only one besides a few here and there, you know, it's not really recognized as a real genre, even though I truly believe that it can tell really powerful stories and stories that mean something, even though, you know, it's not like a clear-cut drama.
Isn't like horror famous for making a ton of movie and a ton of money in the box office?
Yeah. So
like, aren't they extremely cheap movies that make a ton of money?
Yeah, they're extremely cheap. They make a ton of money. They're big crowd pleasers, but I feel like they're a little bit looked down upon by serious film critics and film people. Not to call out names, there's one really big film critic. You know what? His name is Rex Reed. He's really big. I think he works at The Observer.
All right.
Basically, he likes old school musicals. This is pretty off topic, but he likes old school musicals and not a lot else. And he just trashes on horror and any genre film relentlessly. And it's just so unfair, you know? Mm-hmm. And I see that a lot from like auteur film fans and fans of like really classic cinema. And they trash it because they kind of see it as exploitation and not much else. You know, when they think horror, they think something like Friday the 13th, Part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan, where it's just like crazy gore and not a lot else. Yeah. But really, there's so much horror that really means something. Films like Rosemary's Baby, which is really a powerful feminist message during the second wave of feminism at that time. You look at a film like Hereditary, you know, which is a great modern horror film. I think it came out 2018. Which, of course, there's a lot of creepy cults and there's ghosts in it, but really the film is about grief and losing a loved one. And I think why horror works so well is it uses real fears and makes fake fears out of them, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, I like to think about it like this, like the ghost is never a ghost. The ghost is always a symbol. It's a very symbolic genre, and I don't feel like a lot of people see that. And that's kind of why I've stayed by it for so many years.
So I guess what direction are you taking? I guess you're taking your films in the similar direction of like the symbolic, making sure that every film means something. I guess how do you go about that, and how do you craft those stories?
One thing I always try to make sure of, at least for ideas, sometimes for short films, you know, like I made a short film. This is just an example. Last year, The Yellow House Down the Lane.
We're going to talk about in a few minutes.
Oh, fantastic. Well, there's not like any real, truly deep meaning to that one. That one was just fun. But like for ideas where I write a lot of scripts that never get made into anything. And I always try and make sure there's always an underlying message or meaning to horror, to the horror I write. And that there's always, like, it's never just about the monsters. It's about the people and what they're dealing with in their own lives. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we bring in the demons and the serial killers.
So before we start getting into specifics about your movies, do you want to name drop, like, a few influences? Like, who are your favorite filmmakers that have impacted your work the most?
I guess I'll start off with not actually a filmmaker. He's directed a few films, but the ones he's directed weren't great. An author, actually, Stephen King.
Okay.
I've read so much of his work. He's my favorite author. His stories, like, they're so original and so real and also weirdly charming. Mm-hmm. Like, usually the books are set in, like, a small main town. And, you know, of course he brings in, you know, lots of creepy stuff, but also it's like, oh, that's an adorable little pie shop next to the ocean. I want to go there. Then, of course, he brings in the monsters. But yeah, I really love his work. He's been one of the biggest influences. I've been reading him since I was really little. I love him so much.
Have you been able to meet Stephen King?
I have not, but like the obsessive stalker I am, when my family went to Maine a couple years ago, we went to Bangor, Maine, where he lives, and I got to see his house, which is so cool because like he has all these crazy statues. His fence outside has like spiders on it. It's really, really awesome. That was a really cool day.
Only slightly trespassing.
Yeah. Only slightly, yeah. There were lots of other fans outside too. Like there were like five other people all with like bundles of his books. Hoping to meet him too. Yeah. So that was really cool. Oh, for directors, Now I'm not sure. I guess I'll name drop John Carpenter as a big one, the director of the original Halloween. And he's done some really great ones other than that too. Like there's a film called In the Mouth of Madness and Prince of Darkness. Mm-hmm. Those are two of his more underrated ones that have really influenced my stuff. He's just, I can't even put into words. It's John Carpenter. He's so good.
Yeah.
You know, he combines modern horror with classic horror in a really elegant way, and his stuff is always so deep and powerful. Mm-hmm. And one thing I think the biggest thing I've taken from his work is that he never explains everything completely. Like in the original Halloween movie, for example, you know, Michael Myers, before they made like 1200 sequels, Michael Myers is a really mysterious character. And you, of course, learn sort of an origin story, but you never really get a full picture. There's that, the film Prince of Darkness and In the Mouth of Madness. Those, he has a trilogy called the Apocalypse Trilogy. Those are both parts of it. Mm-hmm. There's no connection. They're separate stories. But
that's interesting that they're grouped together, though.
Yeah, because like they kind of share similar themes. There's those two. And then, of course, his classic, The Thing. Everybody loves that one. I personally am not the biggest fan. I think
that's how I am about some, like, Bruce music. Like,
yeah.
It's like, all right, everyone goes crazy for the Born in the USA album. It's a great album. It's a great album. But there's better choices out there.
Definitely, yeah.
But anyway, going back to you. I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, no problem at all. Yeah, so those films, I guess how they're grouped together, they deal with very bleak subjects. And in each of the films, there's never an actual apocalypse, but there's a very apocalyptic feeling where there's this feeling of dread. And there's just something awful coming, hanging over the entire film. And specifically Prince of Darkness and Mouth of Madness, this is what I've taken and put into my films. Like I said before, they never really explain everything. They explain enough to satisfy the audience, but not enough where the audience doesn't have anything left to imagine. Like my film To Become a Witch, which I'm excited to talk about later.
We can talk about it right now, actually.
Great. Yeah. If that's okay, just since I'm moving into it.
Totally.
You know, like in the film, you follow this girl who's becoming a witch, and of course you understand the story and you're satisfied. Okay, so it's kind of like a guideline on how you become something greater than yourself and you gain these powers, and yet you never learn who she is, why she's doing this. I love the element of mystery, and I always want to solve just enough to leave the audience satisfied, but not enough so that they can like fill in the blanks in their head and kind of create their own story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I love the camera work in that, by the way.
Oh, thank you so much.
How do you go about that? Because I was going to ask earlier about like your equipment. I guess, how has your equipment evolved? And To Become a Witch, I thought the camera work was awesome. It's like when you zoom up close to the, what is the main character, the witch carrying like next to her heart?
That's part of the mystery, I guess. I guess just like a statue of whatever thing she worships.
Yeah.
I was actually thinking about making either a prequel or sequel to this film, just like to give a bit more of the picture. You know, I actually found that at a garage sale a few months ago, and I'm like, man, I gotta use this.
That is awesome. I love that.
the way the light hits it, you know, the hood inside of it just pitch black. And so it really gives this dark, mysterious element. And so it's just like whatever she's worshiping. Yeah.
How much film are you usually like recording? Like, did that take like quite a few tries to like get it just right?
Yeah, I'd say the backyard scene where she's holding that scene specifically, it took about an hour, I'd say. Okay. You know, usually scenes, they can take longer or shorter than that. It really depends on what it is. That one just took a while because it was the first thing we filmed that day. And usually the first time, you know, we're getting stuff set up too and all the equipment there and getting everything set up and ready. So, but that one in terms of takes, I think we got it pretty quickly just because, like, you know, we didn't have to reposition a lot. We kept the camera very still. And what we did, we zoomed in on it a little bit, you know, that kind of thing where it like jump cuts to zoom to zoom to zoom.
Yeah.
We kept it there and we just zoomed in a little bit, waited 5 seconds, still recording. And we just kept doing that again and again. And then for that last shot where it kind of pans up, we just zoomed all the way out. And then I just kind of lifted my tripod there. So that one didn't really take that long time.
So you have a tripod. What other equipment do you carry with you?
Yeah, I'm not super professional, you know. I guess.
No, you are very professional. I want you to know that. Your work is fantastic.
Thank you so much. I just meant like in terms of how much stuff I have and how much stuff I use. I guess if I wanted to sound really pretentious, I'd say it's guerrilla style filmmaking where I don't use a lot. But really, it's honestly just really cheap. You know, I have my camera, which is a Canon. It's a really great camera. I have a zoom lens. There are different kinds of lenses I can get. I really want another one just to vary the shots.
Possible Hanukkah present.
Yeah, exactly. If my parents are listening to this, hint, hint, get me another lens. yeah, I have those. I have a mic, which just attaches to the top of the camera. Not that big. I have the tripod too. I have a few different tripods. And honestly, for most shoots, that's all I really use. I'm really simplistic with that.
Cool.
I have a few different things to move the camera around. I have a stabilizer, which is basically a camera but with one leg. So I can just hold it up so that if I want a tracking shot or a shot that moves, the camera's not completely shaky. And I have a few lights in my basement. I did a one-on-one film mentorship. Mentorship, whatever. I'm tired tonight. A few months ago, and the guy, he was Justin, his name was. He also went to Scotch Plains, found a few years ago.
Okay, very
He's
cool.
actually in China now, working for a documentary crew, which is, yeah, it was really great working with him. He gave me a bunch of great experience and a bunch of great tips that I've learned both in screenwriting and filming. Yeah, so he gave me, before he went back to China, he gave me a whole bunch of lights that I've only recently started using.
Sweet.
I have a new film coming out later this month called November. I'm super excited for, and that one is the first time I've really used the lights. The other film you said you want to talk about, Windows. That one I used lights. That was really fun, just playing around with the lights and experimenting with them, where I put the mask up to it. Yeah, that's really all the equipment I use a lot. I have a mini green screen, but I think I've used that like once or twice. I don't use that. It's just collecting dust in my basement at this point.
So before we get back to like the plot behind To Become a Witch, I just want to ask you, I keep coming up with questions as we're going along here. So you're directing, you're editing, you're filming, you're writing the script. Like, does this ever like feel like overwhelming, or like you kind of like figured it all out, I guess? Like, I guess, what's the experience like to be fully in charge of everything?
You know, it really depends on the film. I kind of have two styles, I guess I would say, of short films. There's one where I seriously plan it out, where I write the script, I plan out some shots, then I get my friends, we film everything very by the script, then I edit. And then there is what I like to call like last minute films, where I'm bored on a Saturday and I call my friends up like, hey, you guys want to make a film today? And they're like, we got nothing going on, sure. But yeah, you know, if it's really planned out, it's kind of a daunting task, mainly the pre-production actually. That's the most stressful part to handle alone. because I got to schedule things out and get the script ready and kind of plan out what I'm going to do. And that night before filming is always really stressful, even if the film isn't being submitted everywhere or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah.
Cool. And so when you're filming, you said you call up your friends. When you first went to your friends, like, to ask them for help, like, what was their reaction? And is this kind of just something that they love to do? Or like that you've taught them to love to do, I guess?
Yeah, you know, when I started off, my friends were all really enthusiastic to help. I can't really think of a time anyone was like, if I have to, you know, they've all just been really enthusiastic and great to help me. Some of them are so, so passionate about it. Jacob Jablon and Tessa Going, name dropping, they are in like half of my stuff. They're always super enthusiastic. They're always really great. And Liam Abbott and John Vangeli also, you know, Liam Abbott, he always has fun because I always assign him to play the monster, the serial killer or whatever, just because he's like really, really tall. So he kind of has that presence, like put him in a Jason mask and he's Jason, you know.
The last Noel was fantastic, by the way.
Oh,
thank you so much. Choices behind the last Noel.
Thanks. Yeah, I love the punk vibe in that one. Mm-hmm. I was taking a bike ride one day and I just decided to go under the Fanwood train station bridge, and it was completely graffiti, and I'm like, oh man, I gotta do something here. Mm-hmm. And that was a really fun one to do. I love the whole punk aesthetic, and I want to make for more films like that in the future. But yeah, back to the question, I guess. My friends are all just, they're super great. They're always super enthusiastic to help. Mm-hmm. And it's really fantastic. It definitely takes away some of the stress of like trying to find the right people for the right roles, because I know they can, like, they have a wide range and they can really do whatever, you know? And mm-hmm. they're always just super excited to help, and I'm really, really grateful for it.
Cool.
I'm just kind of interested, going back to what Matt was saying about the stress that comes along with it. Like, a lot of kids will like grow up loving a sport, and then as they get older, the love sort of like fades away as it becomes more competitive or stressful. Yeah. Like, what has kind of kept you going with the film? Because it used to kind of be like, oh, I'm going to film my stuffed animals and have fun. And now it's like serious. So what like keeps you going?
I think, honestly, I just really love it more than anything. Like, there's one director I really like. I forgot to mention this for influences. He's not a huge influence, but I really like him, Adam Green. He made this film called Hatchet, which is just really fun slasher. Anyway, in this one interview, he said that when you apply for film schools and when you want to go into film, you can't have a backup plan. Like, this has to be something you need to do because it's such a competitive industry that you can't have a backup plan. Like, if you think, oh, you know, I want to try going into the film field, but if it fails, you know, I'll try this other thing. I'll like work at a Starbucks or something. Like, no, he said that you need to be on top of it. Like, you need to either keep trying to get into the film industry or die, basically. Not die, but probably not the best choice of words there. But anyway, I just like, it's the only thing I really want to do. And it's the thing I'm most passionate about. And I think that passion has really kept me going. And yeah.
Awesome. So back to Become a Witch. Listeners, hey, we just kind of go with the flow over here. But I definitely want to talk about this. How'd you come up with this idea to become a witch? You talked about John Carpenter. You talked about how he partly influenced like the witch part of it. But how'd you kind of come up with the story? And then what's the hardest part? What was the hardest part about this film?
Huh. Ooh, a lot of good questions. The two biggest influences, I'd say, which is kind of off topic from the question, but, you know, they kind of gave me the idea for this.
Mm-hmm.
For one, this is really specific. I'm obsessed with 1950s Halloween stuff. I love the whole aesthetic, the rockabilly vibe of just like kind of the, you know, the midnight spook shows, the late night horror hosts, that kind of thing. All of the really vintage Halloween stuff.
People dressed up as Buddy Holly.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, rest in peace. So that was a big inspiration. And also there's a period in the 70s. This genre is kind of coming back. Now, I'm going to ask you this. Do you remember a film that came out last year called Midsommar that was kind of big?
Yes.
Yeah. That one, it's in a really weird genre of horror called folk horror. And what folk horror is, since like it's not super well known, it's like, it's one of those, it's really hard to describe. It's like trees and very pagan-y stuff and like very ancient sort of beings, lots of witchcraft, lots of cults and stuff. And I guess sort of the folk horror films of the 70s are what gave me the idea for this. I've The Wicker Man from 1973, my favorite movie of all time. I've been dying to make a film like that. And that was really what gave me the idea for it. It's not really a witchcraft film, but it has a witchy vibe to it. Cool. Yeah, the story itself, it's a pretty simple story. So like there wasn't a huge amount of thought. I just thought like, what's a cool way I can incorporate both the 50s Halloween stuff and folk horror, which are two really oddly specific but really fun things I love.
Yeah.
And so I came up with this plot, like I've wanted to do a witch film for a while too, because witchcraft is something that really scares me. And I read online that you should make horror about things that like really scare you personally so you can try and direct that fear in the audience. And so I kind of had this idea like, oh, what if it's a girl and it's, what if it's like a guidebook almost where it's telling you how to become a witch? And yeah, you know, from there, the rest of it just kind of came to me. We improvised a lot of it on the scene, like when they showed up that day. It was just us three. I never have a huge crew or anything. You know, that one-on-one film mentorship, Justin actually said something. He said, like, I should get a bigger crew. And that's something I have not followed up on whatsoever. I should really start working on that. But yeah, we came up with a lot of it on the spot. A lot of the different camera angles were on the spot. Mm-hmm. One thing that was really fun, you know, in the film The Shrine, where it's like the triangle of branches and the
yeah,
that was really fun because we just like went through the backyard looking for random things to put in it. So that was really fun. Hardest part, I guess it would be the blood splatter scene where she slits her hand and the blood splatters on it. Because I had ordered this thing of blood off Amazon. There's so many great brands for blood. If anyone's listening and they want great recommendations for fake blood, hit me up. But it was just this little squirt capsule and I could just not get the camera angle right and not get it back. If
like you, how many times like did you squirt the blood onto her arm?
So the arm, actually, that was the easy part. Cause like we squirted on our arm. That was good. The hard part was getting it on that stick. It's the shot where it splatters on the wood. And if you'll notice really closely, very briefly, there's the shot where the blood splatters on it. It hits it twice. You'll notice, it goes really fast. You see the blood splatter on one part and then another part, but it's so fast. It looks like one. That's because it was actually two splatters and I sped it up in post-production. Just because like it was the best we could do for that day.
So post-production, what is that experience like? Does that take a long time to kind of figure out which clips you want to take?
Yeah. You know, post-production, I usually try and keep everything. There's never been a film where I've had to cut an entire scene or anything, usually just a line here or there. But it can take a while. Yeah, usually the actual film itself, like how everything's supposed to go, where everybody's set up, that usually goes quickly. What's the hard part is, oh shoot, actually the hardest part is sound editing, I'd say. Editing sound is a painful, painful experience.
Interesting.
Where it's like you have to get, because I don't have a mic guy, you know? I don't have a guy who's holding up the boom over their heads. It's attached to the camera. So you don't get tons of background noise, but you get enough for it to be a distraction. And for a film like To Become a Witch, we shot that in early September. So it was still pretty much summer out. So there's, you know, the sound of all the leaves and the summer bugs and stuff. And that's really challenging because that's, if you have one shot where they sound a certain way and the next shot where it sounds a different way, it'll throw the entire scene off. So I kind of have to make sure like everything's cut so precisely and at the same volume. So that can take a really long time. And once I'm kind of done with that, then it gets to the fun part of editing. And this is one of my favorite parts of the entire filmmaking process, which is color grading, where I color the film different ways. You know, in To Become a Witch, it kind of looks like it's a gray sky in the film.
Yes.
It was a really sunny day that day, actually. That was all post. And I just thought, you know, the sunny day, it just didn't look right for the film. I played around, you know, I added sort of the, not sparks, like the grain over it to make it look sort of like a 70s film.
Because it looked more like a November cold day. Yeah. Than a sunny day in September. So
exactly, that was the vibe I was going for, and I knew I would be releasing it around Halloween, so I knew I had to change a few things. Mm-hmm. But yeah, post-production it's a weird process because it can be so fun and so painful at the same time. You know, right now on this Zoom meeting, I'm on my MacBook Pro, which mm-hmm. is a great computer. I use Final Cut Pro to edit, great editing system. But I used to have, and this was only last year, The Yellow House Down the Lane. I believe that was my last film I edited on a MacBook Air. And the problem with that is that it's the smallest computer ever with the smallest amount of storage. So when I'm editing, it's super laggy and it'll crash every 2 seconds. So post-production used to be a big fear of mine, where every time I would upload it, I would be praying that nothing would go wrong and I could just get it done. But since I've upgraded to this, it's become a much better experience. It can still be long, but it's not like a painful experience anymore.
Do you save everything to your desktop, or do you have it on a flash drive
or hard drive? I have an external hard drive I use when I edit. I usually save it to there. Some things on the desktop, some things on Google Drive. Every few months or so, just to clear up space in my computer, I'll move it all to Google Drive and then delete everything on the computer. Or yeah, move it all to Drive and all to my external hard drive, and then delete everything on the computer just to save that much more space.
I might have to come to you sometime in the future because I keep recording these Zoom meetings to my desktop, and I don't know, I'm not very good. I have to say, I'm not very good with this whole Apple recording process thing. Yeah. I might have to come to you. Just keep your messages open just in case. I might need some help like clearing out my computer or something.
Yeah, of course. If you guys need any like editing or technical help at all, just let me know. You know,
I appreciate that so much. Thank
you.
Yeah,
of course.
So where does this film rank among the rest for you? Is this probably like your favorite project?
Possibly. Yeah, I think it might be. Definitely from a technical standpoint and a filmmaking standpoint, it definitely looks the best and feels the best. I think my favorite overall, though, is kind of tied between The Final Noel and Yellow House Down the Lane. Just because I feel like To Become a Witch, even though it was really great and it turned out great and it was fun making it, it was super exciting. You know, the film, it's really, really short. It's shorter than both those other films. And so, like, everything was really smooth. And I don't know, I feel like Yellow House Down the Lane and The Final Noel, it's like, I felt like I put more heart into it, if that makes sense. I put heart into all my films, but To Become a Witch, it was so short. And I kind of had the idea very last minute, just a couple of days before we filmed. Yeah, I'd say one of the best, definitely, without a doubt, the best technically and filmmaking-wise. But in my own head and for my own enjoyment rewatching, I definitely say those other two.
So The Yellow House Down the Lane, this is a perfect transition here.
Yeah.
This was a special project for you because this is your longest film to date. And this was nearly a 20-minute project, which is incredible, especially for a one-man crew. Like, we're talking about a one-man crew.
Yeah, thanks so much.
So, I love the camcorder. Part one, the camcorder, was so awesome. And I want to...
Thank you so much.
And you released it. You actually released it on the last day that we went to school.
Yeah, yeah.
So, the camcorder scene, tell me about that. So, that was while I could look back at that film to see what life was like before this pandemic.
Exactly, yeah. I remember that's my favorite part rewatching too. You know, this sounds kind of narcissistic. You know, every once in a while, I just like reviewing my stuff and like just going back and watching everything. It's just really
we
fun.
We all do that.
Yeah.
We all do that.
Yeah. But yeah, I remember I filmed that a few months before school completely let out. I remember the scene where we're all in school. I filmed that over lunch. That was the day before winter break, actually. So, and lunch was just ending and I decided, you know, I have my camera on me. Let's film some extra stuff. And yeah, that was really fun. You know, I think I got the vibe of like winter break and everything leaving, which was kind of my goal there. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so that was a really great scene. The rest of the camcorder part one, it was a little awkward, honestly, filming that, because you'll notice that it was pretty much just me in front of the camera, yeah. Just doing my own thing. I'm definitely embarrassed by the scene when, like, he's going from school and walking back home. That part, I cannot watch with a straight face anymore, because it's, like, it's just me talking about random stuff.
But it reveals, some important details about you. Like,
yeah,
you kind of open yourself up, which I really like.
Yeah, thank you. It's definitely an important scene. I wish I had found a better way to do it, because it is just like still so embarrassing. But you know, I originally, when I first made this film, I went to John Vangeli, who I'll shout out now as kind of an assistant director to this film, who I didn't credit in the credits, but alongside being an actor, he also gave me some great ideas, especially for the school scene and his improv there. Because the school scene, when we're like looking to find stuff for the essay, that was all completely improvised. This whole film was unscripted and just like us. Like, I'd gone to him a few weeks before the first time we filmed over that lunch break. And I was like, listen, I've been wanting to do a full length film for a while. Let's just say screw it and do it. And like, it may turn out terrible, but let's just make, you know, an easy to make found footage type film. And, yeah, so that just kind of explains why there's all that time of me just talking, because like there was a lot of filler in that film too, because we really wanted to make it full length, you know. And the reason I stopped wasn't even because like it was almost weighing on me, if that makes sense. Like, I didn't feel like I could make any other projects until this one was complete. And when you're making something as long as this, you know, that's going to take a while. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't have the patience. And that's why the film ends kind of abruptly there. And, you know, it's chapter one and chapter two. We planned on doing like three more chapters or something. And kind of like, so
fans want to see that.
Yeah, I think I may have to make a sequel to that one, because I left that one kind of on abrupt notice at the end there. Yeah,
it had a very... One of my favorite shows of all time is The Office.
Yeah.
And like, we know how like The Office, like the camera work and that.
Yeah.
It had a very Office vibe to it. Because a lot of The Office too was came off of improv.
Yeah, definitely.
I love the elements of like that improv, and that's kind of, it's like you think about horror and you think about like the gory Friday the 13th type of film.
Yeah.
You change that, like you change that scene, and there's definitely some dark comedy in chapter one, which is super cool.
Thank you. Yeah.
So Yellow House Down the Lane, I really thought that film was very well done.
Thank you so much.
Are these ideas, I remember when I came up with this idea for the podcast, I just finished watching the final episode of The Last Dance, the Michael Jordan documentary from last spring with my dad. And I remember I was thinking about it. I had the lights off. I was about to go to sleep. I was thinking about how much of an impact Jordan had on my dad's generation. Yeah. And I thought about my generation over and over again until I hatched this idea.
Oh, okay.
Is this an idea that you kind of pops into your head like while you're in the shower or while you're about to go to sleep? Or are these kind of ideas that you're constantly thinking about, like maybe during the school day, maybe you read something online?
Yeah. Do you mean just ideas in general or for this film specifically?
Well, I guess I'll make it specific to this film.
Yeah.
But then also like all your past ideas as well.
For this film, this one actually has a really interesting origin story, I think, and how I first got the idea. I was biking with Liam Abbott, who of course plays the scarecrow demon thing in this film. Again, thank you, Liam, for always being willing to kill my other friends in masks and stuff. And we were biking and he said he wanted to show me something. And I'm like, yo, what's this going to be? And so he takes me down the street. Actually, I'm looking out the window and I can see to the street. Like, it's a bit of a bike, but it's like, you know, it's a 2-minute ride or something just around the corner. And I see like this little patch of woods between these two houses. Mm-hmm. And he walks me down and it's this abandoned house, you know, and it's completely, it's terrifying. It's really creepy. There's a crushed shed. It's overlooking the train tracks, actually. You'll notice in the film, and you know, because Fanwood train station is down that way. But it was honestly just, it was a little creepy, but in a good way, you know, where it's like, I've lived in the same house. I've never moved for 17 years, and I never knew there's this pretty spooky place just around the corner, and I love horror. And I knew when he showed me that, like, this is insane. This is really creepy. And there's graffiti scrawled in it saying things like, go die, a-hole, and yeah. And I'm like, I got to do something with this. So I think that was kind of a really cool origin story for that film. Yeah.
If you had to choose one, would you choose that house or the tunnel underneath the Fanwood train tracks where you filmed the final Noel?
You know, you know, they both look so cool after I put the filters on and stuff. I think I gotta go with the house, actually, though. Just because I made another film a while ago called Two Tales of Terror. Mm-hmm. And I filmed at another abandoned house on Terrell Road that's really old and red. We actually got caught filming there. Some lady was like, I could see her taking out her phone to call the police that day. And we're like, no, we're not causing any harm. We're just making a dumb student horror film. So that was a little scary. Anyway, I'm getting off topic.
I just have a quick question. Yeah. When you had to go up to that lady and tell her, hey, we're just going to make a student horror film, what was her reaction? Was she like, hey, that's so cool, or like, hey, get away from me, like, right now?
It was like, we kind of yelled at her, not yelled at her, but just because we were from a distance. Mm-hmm. We went there to film, this was Halloween 2018 or 2019, I honestly don't remember, 2020 is a mess, I don't remember years before this. So we were filming there, and we could see this woman getting out of her car, older woman, and then what looked like her in-home helper or nurse or maid or something get out too. And I could see them look at each other, and the maid slowly starts taking out her phone, and I can see her pointing at us. And so then the older woman yells out, can we help you? And I'm like, yeah, we're just making a short film. A short film. Yeah, so we raised the camera and pointing at it, and she's like,
oh my God.
And her and the maid walk into the house. So I'm a little frightened to go back to that place. So
that's an awesome anecdote right there.
Yeah, it was scary at the time, but it's pretty fun. Yeah.
Is there anything, so that was 2 years ago now. Is there anything you would change about that experience, about how you handled it?
I mean, not really.
There's not much you could do in those situations.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, it's not like we were super suspicious, you know, she sees, you know, this blonde chubby kid holding a camera wearing probably like a Halloween sweater or something at the time. You know, I don't give off the vibe of someone who's going to egg your house or someone who's smoking dope or something in an abandoned house or something. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think I don't want to put the blame on her. I mean, she was probably nervous that we were filming at this abandoned place next to her house, but also like, she was pretty quick to jump to start filming us suspiciously.
Yeah.
It was weird. It was just a little weird, you know?
So last question about Yellow House Down the Lane. So when you were filming in the media center, like there were people in that media center. Like how do you go about like addressing, I don't know, you pull out your camera? Like, how do like you address that?
Well, that day, we pretty much walk in there and start filming. We may have said something to the librarian, because, you know, when we set out to make that film, it wasn't like it was a short film. It wasn't anything we could ever submit to a festival, just because, mm-hmm. like, I knew that even if it was a full-length film, it would probably only end up being, like, 50 minutes or something, just kind of that weird length in between short and full-length. That film was mainly just for me and for us and to have fun. It wasn't like anything serious submitting anywhere. So like, I didn't really feel the need to ask for permission or anything, just cause like, it was just us goofing off with the camera for that film.
All right, so windows.
Yes.
This is a cool film. So thank you. This was a selection for the All-American High School Film Festival.
Yep.
And so you, I don't know, maybe I stalked your YouTube page for a few minutes. Maybe. You mentioned that for this film in the comments.
Yeah.
You composed the music for this project.
Yes. Yeah.
And I think that is so, so amazing.
Thank you so much.
Like, yeah. Wow. Like, how did you do it? Like, that's like a massive step, because you're not only a director, editor, screenwriter, producer, filmmaker now, filmmaker, you're also a composer. Like, you just step into like a whole new territory. So like, what was that like? And then on top of that, the first time that you did that, you got selected into a film festival.
You know, it was really just me playing around. You know, I'd shot this thing, and when I tell people about this film, I don't really describe it as a film. I kind of think of this one, you know, it's a film about COVID, and it's kind of just my feelings. This was also at a point before, like, people could see friends again. And this was at a point before, you know, like, things had started opening up a bit, and
it was a great world of unknown.
Yeah, it was. Oh, exactly. It was before we knew a lot about this virus. So there was still, like, even though there's still fear now, you know, we've kind of adapted to it and gotten a bit more used to it as a society. But back then, it was still really, really scary. So I kind of wanted to just put, like, very raw emotions into an experimental film. Mm-hmm. And so I knew for the music, this film was inspired a lot off of David Lynch, who is another inspiration for me. I've never really done anything based off his work, but he's a fantastic experimental drama horror filmmaker. He did Twin Peaks, Eraserhead. He's a complete whack job, but he is a great filmmaker. And so I wanted the music to be really weird. I couldn't really find anything online, because usually I just find stuff online, try and find royalty-free stuff that sounds good. Mm-hmm. Purple Planet Music is usually my go-to site for horror music. So I figured at some point I'd used the site called Soundtrap before. I remember actually at Terrell Middle School in fifth grade, the music teacher at the time, Mr. Cale Thompson, had told us to check out this site, and it was kind of what we were allowed to do in our free time, just play around with it. And so I remembered. So years later, I just started playing around with it for this film. And I knew
Mr. Thompson, shout out.
Yeah. Oh, hope you're doing good, Mr. Thompson, if you're listening to this somehow. But yeah, since it's experimental, I wasn't trying to create like a really fun, fast-paced song or anything. I just wanted something to kind of match the emotions of the film. And so I kind of created this like sort of creepy, sort of techno weird flute sound. And then I just kind of repeated it again and again. It wasn't super, super difficult. And I didn't really think of it as making my own music until it was all together. I'm like, oh, holy crap, this is kind of cool. And so that was really fun. I'm not sure if I'd do it again, just because there's not a lot of films where that kind of stuff works. And, you know, I play a bit of guitar, but it's not like I know music like a crazy amount or anything. So it's not like, you know, I could write completely original scores or anything. But if I ever make an experimental film like this again, I'd definitely try doing something like it.
Sweet. Yep. So now that we kind of spoke about your films, I want to bring this kind of like, I guess, broaden the scope a little bit. Have you thought about making films outside of horror?
Yes, actually. You know, I kind of had a realization over the pandemic. It's not that I don't like horror anymore, even though that sounds like a crazy jump. I'm starting to get back into it, actually. But for the past few months, I've kind of taken a break and just been watching films of other genres and stuff. And I realized I kind of want to expand my horizons. And actually, I made a film with my girlfriend, actually, a couple weeks ago called November, that I'm really, really excited about. And it's not horror whatsoever. It's set during COVID, but it's really lighthearted and it's a comedy. It's not like dark or anything. It's just, it's funnier and weird. And I kind of tried to do some not bizarre things, just like quirky things. It was inspired off of the works of Wes Anderson a lot, you know, director of Fantastic Mr. Fox, Grand Budapest Hotel. And yeah, so that was a big departure for me, not doing a big creepy horror thing. And sweet. I'm really excited for it.
I'm excited for it.
No, thanks.
No, so comedy, I don't know, because comedy, like, there's a lot of bad comedy films out there.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of bad films. Like, was it a struggle for you, or did you find it difficult, or did you kind of feel like everything fit right into place?
You know, it was definitely difficult. Actually filming it, it was a pretty easy shoot. It was quick, it was fun, there was no stress at all. I think the most difficult part was writing the script, even though I have done comedy before, mm-hmm. and they're usually horror comedies, you know? I usually incorporate some element of horror. And I think, honestly, the most difficult part, was getting the script off the ground. And that's really the most difficult part of any script I write, really, this or horror or anything else. But especially something here where I'm exploring a new genre, where I start off at, it's like, where do I go from here? You know, I get the first lines down, but I'm just not really 100% sure where to go with stuff.
Yeah.
You know, so it was a bit of a daunting task, not making comedy, I'd say, but just making something at this level comedy, you know, where I've kind of improved a lot as a filmmaker. I haven't made comedy in a while, you know, of course, except for like horror comedies and stuff. Like, I did a film called Nightmare Nutcracker a couple years ago that was still just a really fun film to make. But it's been years since, you know, my really, really early stuff with stuffed animals. Those were all funny. None of those were horror because, you know, yeah. I can't make a stuffed animal scary. It was a bit of a daunting task writing the script, like I said, but really once I got into the swing of things, it went by pretty smoothly.
Cool.
Yeah.
I want to ask you a question. What do you think about, like, we have all these streaming platforms now. Like, Warner Brothers is also putting all their movies now onto HBO Max, which is kind of, it's killing movie theaters.
Yeah.
Like, what are your thoughts on how everything is all about streaming? And do you see this as a positive, or are you not a fan of kind of streaming services taking over?
First off, thank you for asking this. Like, I was literally, I've been thinking about this the past couple days with the whole Warner Brothers slate being pushed to streaming. You know, I was really against it at first. I'm still really against it for the most part, because I think we're getting the vaccine now. And even though, of course, everything's not going to magically get okay, mm-hmm. I think for something like, you know, if you're masked up, like just going to a movie and seeing it with no crowds or anything, I don't think. And, you know, these are films that were coming out next summer and stuff. These aren't films like coming out in the next couple weeks that are being pushed to digital. This is their entire slate for 2021, which is just crazy. But the one positive I saw, I follow this one YouTube critic, Chris Stuckman, who's also becoming a filmmaker. He's great. His reviews are great. He's so entertaining. But he had a video about it. And one of the positives he made, he's discussed this on the channel, like annoying people in the movie theater, people on their phones, people talking so loudly to their friends.
People scrolling through Facebook.
Yes, thank you. Oh my gosh, it is just...
My mom is guilty of that.
It's my number one pet peeve, you know? Phones, actually, I don't mind. It's the talking that I can't stand and the screaming.
Well, like, that would belong to my brother. Usually at a movie theater, it would be my brother, Ryan, then my dad in the middle, and then me on the other side.
Yeah.
And after every scene, whispers over here.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, STFU, just stop.
See, here's the thing though, like as someone else in the audience, I wouldn't notice that, you know, whispers are fine. I was guilty of that when I was little. It's like, it's the giant groups of 18, 19 year olds going, usually it's PG-13 horror movies. Usually those are the biggest offenders. Rated R horror movies, they're loud, but they're fun loud, where it's like people, like, you know, people screaming, oh hell no, when they enter the door, or like people laughing along or screaming along. But it's really like PG-13 horror movies, these groups of teens screaming profanities. I saw this one film a few years ago, and don't even remember what film it was, you know, couple 19-year-olds next to me just full-on making out next to me. Just like, and I'm like 12 years old or something at the time, man. I don't want to see that. I want to watch some dumbass PG-13 horror movie. And it's like full-on. It was, ugh.
If only anyway. With reserved seating, you could see who's going to be sitting right around
yeah,
you.
Yeah, yeah. And I remember it was just really crowded. Generally, the theater that day was pretty good, but the, oh man, ugh. But yeah, the one positive I saw is that if more films start to go streaming, it means that these people who like talking and who like screaming at the screen and just not paying attention to the film and just doing something to do, mm-hmm. It means that they're less likely to go to the theater and see it, and they're more likely to stay home and watch the streaming. And this means that the only people at the theater will be the people who really just love the movie theater experience and sure. are really excited to see a film on the widescreen. Mm-hmm. And I do think that's the one positive, is that the audiences will get better. And I think at the same time, though, the biggest hit will be independent films from this. Because, mm-hmm. you know, the major studios, they're going to be on streaming and in theaters. They have both of those.
And a lot of independent films are excellent.
Yeah, thank you. Like, they're
yeah. fantastic.
Yeah, like, I prefer them over... Actually, you know, I shouldn't say that. Hollywood's been doing better in the past couple of years, I should say. There was a period from, like, mid-2000s to mid-2010s. They were pretty bad, but they've really looked up.
Yeah.
But... independent films, you know, they don't have the money to be distributed across 30,000 streaming services. Their only option is movie theaters and being shown at in art house theaters.
And so are those horror movies going to be severely affected? Like, are they made by a lot of, are they independently made films in many cases?
It depends on which one and like what kind of film we're talking. Usually like the Blumhouse crowd pleasers, like, they're going to be fine. You know, horror movies are also, it's also one of the most popular genres, as we talked about earlier. So horror movies really should be okay generally, except for independent art house ones, stuff like Ari Aster films or A24 stuff. But my biggest fear, you know, these big studios, they have the money to put their films on all these streaming services, and that takes away the need for movie theater. And when audiences get into their heads, oh, I don't have to go to a movie theater anymore, then there's no point in them going out at all. And that's going to really affect independent films. And I'm really scared for that, actually. Like, because I love it so much. Like, and just independent theaters in general, I love the experience more. I love small independent theaters more than any AMC or Cinemark.
Like the one in Cranford.
Yeah, exactly. The one in Cranford's great. They showed...
those seats are tough to sit in.
Yeah, yeah. It's great, but they show really great stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. And there's one in Montclair, New Jersey, Bowtie Cinemas. They show stuff that I never would have ordinarily heard of. And I think that's really great, because if you lose movie theaters, you're losing a lot of foreign films and a lot of independent films. And that's just really awful. And their best case scenario is, like, you know, after several months, they get put on Amazon Prime for $2 and no one's going to see that. And so honestly, I'm, like I said before, when it comes to big budget films, I could care less. They have the money, they're going to be fine. But for smaller independent films, I am very worried. Yeah.
So as we're wrapping up here.
Yeah.
Give me your 5 favorite movies of all time.
Oh, one sec. Let me check my phone. This is super nerdy of me. I have this app called Letterboxd, which you track all of your favorite movies and different films and stuff.
And hey, I dig it.
Yeah. Man.
And were you a big Sopranos? Are you a big Sopranos fan?
Yeah, I actually, my family and I, we watched it over quarantine. And I
watched it over quarantine too.
Yeah, it's so good. Incredible. It's so good. Yeah. Incredible. We actually, as a family, we took a self-guided tour of the Sopranos spots in New Jersey. And it was a lot of fun. There was construction on one of the roads, so we had to kind of find a really sneaky way to Tony's house. But we ate at Holstein's Diner outside where they filmed the last scene.
Okay.
That was really cool.
That's awesome. And have you seen Mad Men too?
You know, I've watched the first season and loved it. I just couldn't get into it after that. You know, I see why people loved it. It just wasn't my thing really.
Because I followed Sopranos up with Mad Men since the creator of the show, one of his top guys was the creator of I forgot their names.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah.
I'm a big Mad Men guy too.
Yeah. Yeah, no, the first season, I can see it's really well done, and I can see that it's just, like, fantastic. It's just, like, I watched the first season, it was great, and then it got more into the characters, and of course I love characters, because characters in movie, you know?
Yeah.
But I really loved season one. They really focused a lot more on the, like, 60s aesthetic,
mm-hmm.
and less on, like, the drama and stuff, so, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Top five favorite movies up?
I do. I have my top four, and then at the end, I'll think of one on the spot.
All right.
So number four slot is Ghost World. I believe it's from 2001 or 2000. Really fantastic film. That's definitely the arts. Well, yeah, I'd say it's the quirkiest. You know, it's just like, you know, weird, quirky girls doing their own thing for 90 minutes. It's really fantastic. It has a really comic booky vibe. It just, it's very colorful, and it is just one of the most hipstery films you'll ever see. And yeah.
Like that.
Next up, we have Uncut Gems, I put down here, which came out last year.
Love it's Uncut Gems.
It's so good.
Noah.
I'm sorry, that's disgraceful. That's absolutely
Noah hates Uncut Gems.
Are you serious? Oh, it's so good. It's so
there's
good.
There's nothing good about that. I'm sorry.
Oh my god.
I'm sorry. There's nothing good about that movie.
No.
I cannot believe that came out of your mouth.
Yeah. I get that. Like, I love it, but my mom, for instance, hated it. But, like, I absolutely loved it. I love the Safdie brothers, you know.
I'm in shock right now.
Yeah.
Safdie Brothers. I'm a big fan of the Safdie Brothers too.
Yeah, they also did Good Time, which was great. Their style is so, like, fiercely original and, like, this immersive filmmaking where it's shaky. It's just makes you feel awful, but I love it so much.
It's 2 hours of nonstop. It's
exactly.
Just nonstop.
You don't get a chance to breathe, and that's what I loved about it. And also, I just love New York City in general. It's my favorite place in the world, and I love anything set there. So I think their style, where it's like people screaming over each other and just really fast-paced, it really works well with the city. And one thing, I saw this in a YouTube comment, actually, on a short film they made. They have a really common theme in their films, I think is interesting, of old-school New York versus new New York. Like, for example, Uncut Gems, you know, it's, you know, this, like, old school Diamond District Jewish guy with all these modern basketball players and rappers and, like, in a really fast-paced modern world, and him kind of, like, just very calm with it, and he's not really up to speed with this modern world. Yeah. And that, you know, spoilers for Uncut Gems, I guess skip 5 seconds ahead or something if you haven't seen it. You know, that leads to his ultimate fate because, like, he's just not prepared for this world.
Noah, what did you not like about the film? Yeah, I guess
there was nothing to like. It was 2 hours of nonstop awfulness.
Well, it's awful about it though.
I was sitting there waiting for something to happen and nothing happened.
Nothing happened
the whole movie. You can't argue that anything happened the whole movie. We were just waiting for something to happen and nothing happened.
You know, I disagree, Noah, but I get it. It's a very divisive movie. And I understand why people don't like it, even though I personally loved it.
So your first watch, were you in love with it?
Yeah, I remember. I saw it on New Year's Eve last year, you know, right before 2020 happened. So I guess it was kind of like the prelude to the stress that was going to happen throughout 2020.
Well, yeah, because, like, it's so funny that that movie is just, like, so intense nonstop. Yeah. And that's what this year has been.
Exactly. And I saw it on New Year's Eve, and I saw it with my mom, and it was just, we had bought seats like two rows from the front because we didn't know it was going to be this kind of movie. And suddenly it's just like shaking in front of their faces. I remember my mom was like scraping at the seat, just like in total stress. We both walked out of there with a headache, but it was the best headache I've ever had. You know?
No, we're gonna have to rewatch that together.
You're not getting me anywhere near that.
Incredible. I was not expecting that. And that's the
agree with me that film was. I just don't understand. You either love it or hate it, I guess.
I've looked at from a lot of the fan reviews. That seems to be the case. Like, you either think, "Oh, it's so inventive because it made me nauseous," or "Oh, it's so awful because it made me nauseous." You know?
Incredible.
Yeah.
All right, let's hear the number two slot.
Yeah.
I don't think as far as like discussion wise, I don't think the number three slot was probably the best discussion. I don't think you could follow that up with anything better.
Yeah, so the next film I have, it's a Dutch-French film from 1988. The original title is Spoorloose, but in English, it's The Vanishing. It is I wouldn't exactly call it a horror film. It's really more of a suspense thriller and mystery. And why I love it, and it's very similar to my number one spot for this same reason, but this one I actually think does it a little bit better. The entire film is just nothing. Not nothing, but like the basic premise, I won't give away too much. This guy's wife goes missing while they're on vacation, and it cuts to 3 years later and he's still looking for her. And suddenly he gets a phone call from this guy saying he knows what happened to her. And it's just, the entire film is very slow. There's a lot of really boring parts actually, you know, where it's like watching paint dry, and the entire film is build up to a 2 minute sequence at the end that is awesome. The most terrifying scene I have ever seen. Like, if you took it out of context and you just watched the scene, it would be, oh yeah, it's creepy, but like, you know, I've seen worse. But after just an hour and a half of just slowness, and you suddenly realize like why it's so slow, and you make all these connections in your head, and it's just crazy. It's it still gives me chills. And that's one of those ones where it just stays with you and you know it's never going to leave. I remember even the first night I saw it, I slept perfectly fine. The biggest misconception about horror film fans is that we don't get scared of horror. We get just as scared. It's just that when we start getting scared, we don't turn the TV off. We turn up the volume. That's just how we work. And, you know, the first night I felt nothing. I'm like, oh, that was kind of cool. But then the next day, the entire day, I just spent, you know, this was during quarantine. So like this was during the period where school wasn't all online and it was just us printing out stuff and doing them. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was a lot of nothing days. And so I just spent the entire day just thinking and like, oh, that's what he meant by that line. And if that's how it ends, then that means and making all these connections. And it's just really freaky.
Awesome.
And my number one spot, I guess, is 1973 classic. They made a Nicolas Cage remake, which is just horrendous. But the 73 classic, The Wicker Man, is, I personally think, the best horror movie ever made. In my opinion, the best movie ever made. I just think it's completely brilliant. Everything that's wrong with it, like everything in it that people would consider a flaw, like all of its cheesiness, all of its weirdness, and the things that people would think, oh, you couldn't say that nowadays, I think it works towards its favor. It's just, this was my biggest influence for it to become a witch, I think. I have a lot of, it's a very pagan film, and in Become a Witch, you'll notice a lot of my camera angles are from the ground. There's one shot where it's like you see grass in front of the camera, and it's pointed up at her, because I wanted it to be like the earth was watching her. And this movie has a lot of the same vibes, where it's very nature-y. It follows this guy, he's an English police officer who gets called by the Scottish Islands. Apparently a little girl had gone missing, and he goes to investigate. And when he goes there, everybody claims she doesn't exist and that they've never met her. And it's just like, it's funny. There's a lot of really funny parts just from how purely weird it is, but it's all build up to the ending. Again, there's sort of a twist in it. It's kind of obvious, but anyway, I love it so much, and it's about religion, and it's about paganism, and it's about God, and it's about sex, and it's about all these human emotions, and it's just, it gets scarier the more you think about it, and once you look at the different meanings, and there's so many subtleties in this movie too. It's very subtle, and there's so many lines where you got to think about for a while, and then you're like, oh, okay. And a lot of hidden meanings and stuff. It's just a fantastic film. So I think I'd consider that my number one favorite of all time.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Julian, thank you again for coming on tonight.
Thank you guys so much for having me.
No, your insight, yeah. And I learned so much about the filmmaking process tonight from you. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate you coming on. And I'm going to leave all of Julian's link, YouTube pages. I could also link your Instagram page. I'll leave that all in the podcast description, as well as the comments on the YouTube post. But thank you again, Julian. Quick question.
Yeah.
Do you like The Usual Suspects?
Who doesn't? You know, it's a classic. Right?
All right, last question.
Yeah.
Is Die Hard a Christmas movie?
Oh my gosh. I have had so many screaming arguments with my uncle about this. You know, it is. I don't see why it's not. Thank you. Yeah, it's like it's during Christmas. There's so many Christmas one-liners. Ho, 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 I have a machine gun. They play Christmas music. I don't see why it's not Christmas, you know? It's everything is Christmas.
I like that.
Yeah.
So we'll leave it on that note. Noah, you have anything to add before we go?
No, I don't think it's a Christmas. I don't understand why it has to be a Christmas movie.
It's a Christmas movie.
I don't know.
To our listeners, I know this is our first podcast in a couple weeks. Look for a few more podcasts before this year is out. We're going to try to do another live podcast. I was thinking about on the first night of Hanukkah, but I don't know how I'm going to swing that one. maybe I'll get a little candle lighting special in there for you guys. But Julian, once again, thank you.
Yeah.
Noah,
thank you so much for having me.
As always. And I'm gonna leave us with one of my new favorite songs by the band Bleachers. This is called Chinatown. So thank you guys. And have a great one. Oh, and listeners, you guys could hop off at any time. I'm just gonna let this music play for a few minutes. And Julian, if you have anywhere to go, feel free to hop off as well. I appreciate you guys.
Thank you again, Matt, for having me. This was so much fun. And happy holidays, happy Hanukkah,
happy Hanukkah,
Christmas, whatever.
I'll see you in class tomorrow, virtually.
Yeah, Global Perspective. See you there.
See you, Julian. Thank you again.
Bye-bye. Thank you again.